Thank you. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay, there you go, yeah. So should I give you this start? Okay, good, yeah. So good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure for me to welcome you, also in the name of my colleague Michel Su, to the RecSys 2014 conference here in Foster City, Silicon Valley, California. Originally, I planned to start out with the mission of this year's edition of the conference, but then I thought, well, this year's conference was quite unusual. Maybe I also should start in an unusual manner. And I thought, jokes work always quite well. Let's start with a joke. It's a joke about three doctors who have an email conversation. Doctor one says, I would estimate more or less the same number of attendees, around 300 to 350. 400 would be the max. I have this in writing. Dr. Two says, I looked at the breakdown of the past 2 years, 300 conservative, 400 optimistic. Dr. Three says, sounds good to me. Where's the joke? Well, this was RecSys 2014, back in 2012, 2013, when the conference was being planned. So we did everything methodologically, looked at historical data, looked at the location, and came to these estimates. Now, here is how it looked in real life. These shows a graph of the attendance figures. This is early July this year, when we announced that the registration system was open, and like 20 people registered. This is towards the end of July, when we kicked and screamed that authors of accepted papers should have at least one person registered for the conference, and we got like 80 people registered total. Then it went down all the month of August, two registrations, one registration. At the end of August, we had 170 registrations, roughly. Then we announced the early registration deadline is coming up. And oops, we had 20 registrations in one day, one single day. And oops, went down again. Was this it? Well, there was a little bit sign of life still, and then it went through the roof. In the last 3 days, we got nearly as many registrations as we got in the previous 2 months. So we had to first soft close and then hard close the conference. Unfortunately, it could also not be physically expanded anymore. You see that there is another group next door, so we couldn't rent this anymore. But we still allowed for registrations to workshops. Now, of course, I'm a scientist, and scientists always turn problems into challenges. How about a RecSys challenge that tries to predict and give recommendations to conference organizers about the likely attendance figure based on historical data and, of course, also of context factors? Here, this high attendance rate is clearly influenced by locality. So maybe people who run RecSys challenges might be an idea for the future that you can integrate into the ACM Rec online registration system. Okay, now I start with the mission of this year's RecSys. It was to strengthening the ties between industry and academia by bringing this conference right into the heart of Silicon Valley. There are already strong ties. As you know, the industry attendance is pretty high, but we wanted to really bring it here down to Silicon Valley to give people an opportunity to attend who would otherwise maybe not travel. And this goal has been very much reached. So we ultimately had 500 participants. And this is now a little bit black magic. Nearly half of those are from industry, one third from academia, and a little bit less than a quarter are students. And here's a breakdown by company, and we see that Google and Google Inc. together have the lion's share in industry participation, then LinkedIn, Netflix, Yahoo Lab, YouTube, Groupon, Alibaba. And country-wise, it's kind of a bit lopsided. US, China, Japan are the top three countries. But just 1 year ago when the conference was held in Hong Kong, it was kind of the opposite. Now this conference had a large program committee. And I show the pictures of those people who were able to come to the conference here so that you can walk up to them and thank them for the efforts. So Michelle and I were the general co-chairs. Martin and Yehuda, who unfortunately couldn't come, were the program chairs. Anmol and Joachim, the industry chairs. Then we had workshop chairs, tutorial chairs, doctoral symposium chairs, poster chairs, a proceedings chair, publicity chairs, and a treasurer. And finally, quite a lot of people participated in all sorts of local arrangements. So Xian, I don't see her, was in charge of the student volunteers, and she was also in charge of the reception at the Computer History Museum tonight. So if you like this excursion, let her know. Susan from IBM worked with us. Chalal took care of projectors and easels. Don't laugh about the easels. Those were a nightmare for him. Agustin produced the brochure, and Michelle was in charge of hotel selection, industry sponsors, hotel food. If you like the ice cream yesterday, let her know. We noticed you didn't like the oranges. And I myself also took care of hotels, registrations. I thought it would be an easy job, but no. Video. And music at the banquet. And finally, the young ladies and gentlemen in the LinkedIn t-shirts that you see around here, they are not recruiters, but rather those are our student volunteers who have already worked extensively for the conference. And if you have any questions, they will be happy to help you. A video recording. You see Cliff Rosa here working. He is our video recorder. So since there was so much interest in this conference that we couldn't meet, we decided to video stream the conference on a YouTube channel. And also the video recordings of the full papers will be integrated into the ACM Digital Library. But both only if you agree, if the presenters agree, and you express your agreement by signing this one-page copyright form, only the one page that's perfectly satisfactory, and turning it in to Cliff. If you don't do that, we will play some advertisement during your presentation. And during the banquet, there is this demo and poster session, and also Cliff will walk around and record presentations if you wish. Also give him the copyright transfer form. But we have no production plans yet for these presentations. Now, if you didn't read my email message, there is a wireless here that we bought from the hotel, and here are the credentials for joining it. Courtesy requires that you should not stream on the hotel's wireless during the time when we hold this conference, and even not in your own room. There are also no video streaming between 8:30 to 6:30. Do your occasional Skype talk, that's no problem, but don't stream video, specifically not YouTube, of course. All right, that's it from my side, and now Michelle will present more pleasant sides of the conference.
Right, it's working? Okay. So one of the things I have to say is, among of you, I'm pretty sure in the future you will be organizing a conference like this, but keep in mind, you want to really, really find a German co-chair. So I have to thank Alfred for doing all the work, a lot of work, right? And he's particularly very meticulous. And sometimes he drive my previous assistant, Susan, actually crazy, because Susan has to print all your badges with very many different variations, many, many parameters there. So just keep in mind, when you select your co-chairs, be very, very careful. You want somebody who's meticulous, who actually cares a lot about the conference. So I want to thank Alfred for being my great co-chair. And by the way, I have co-chaired quite a few conferences. This is one of the best experiences so far. And let me see where next one. Okay, so how many of you actually enjoyed ice cream bar yesterday afternoon? Ah, not some of them haven't yet. I see Mary here. And once you enjoy today's lunch, tomorrow's lunch, the after tomorrow's lunch, and tonight's reception at Computer History Museum, and tomorrow's banquet, you will so much appreciate how much our sponsors have done for us. Again, for those of you who have ever organized a conference like this size, you know that the most expensive, but also most important item is the food. And the food is just cost so much, you never know. So actually, most of the sponsors' money will actually go to your belly. So let's give a huge applause, a round of applause to our sponsors. So I want to call out our diamond sponsors from Netflix and LinkedIn, and the platinum sponsors from Google, Pandora, Amazon, Yahoo Labs, Baidu, and our golden sponsors from Facebook, Comcast, IBM Research, and also a server sponsor, Spoder, from the NSF, especially for those of you on Friday, if you're going to enjoy your doctor consortium program, that will be coming actually from NSF. And this year is just amazing for the number of sponsors we have and for the amount of money we have received. Even at the last day, minute, we still receive actually sponsorship from the one of the companies. So one of the things I have to actually make it very, I want to clarify, because some of the company raised the concerns, because when you see the program brochure, we say this, oh, because some companies are sponsor some keynotes, right? And it's, for example, like, I'm just picking an example, right? If Google sponsors Netflix or something like that. But I don't want you to take it in a wrong way, because as I said earlier, most of our sponsors' money really, really goes to your, will go to your belly, right? It's just, but nobody tells us, wants to say, okay, please name this food after my company. For example, we can well do it is Netflix will sponsor, let's say, the Chinatown dim sum tomorrow at the banquet. Or somebody will sponsor the pasta dishes, the pasta station, or the turkey carving station tomorrow you're going to enjoy. Nobody wants to do that. So everybody wants to be associated with a better names, like let's say the keynotes, but we don't have many, many of those kind of events, right? So I just want you especially for the people who are coming from industry, representing the companies. I don't want you to take the wrong impression. Actually, the money goes to the speakers or goes to anywhere. No, actually, that go to all of our bellies, tomorrow, today, and the day after. And then, so this is the kind of the things that we want to acknowledge as the way to acknowledge our sponsorship. And you will enjoy so much tonight. So tonight we have our reception at the Computer History Museum. I'm not sure how many of you actually have been there. Great, not many. So actually I have lived in this area for past five years. I have never been to the Computer History Museum. And this is the location for some of you who are local, you want to drive yourself, but we'll have a bus to pick you up at 6:30 and it returns to the hotel at 10 o'clock. And please remember, often they ask me to remind every one of you, bring your badges, especially with the label from Tuesday and Thursday, and we all have purchased the tickets. And for some of you, if you want to bring your, I'm not sure, can they still purchase tickets right now? Oh no, okay, it's closed already. And this is a buffet and free bar. And free bar, actually, after they put the very mark there. And also remind yourselves that no backpacks or large bags in the exhibit area. So let's just make sure don't bring those things with you. And more fun tomorrow on the poster and demo session night. So it's our also banquet. So it's starting at, it will start at 7 o'clock until 9:30. So you have a chance to actually mingle as well as to enjoy a lot of great food. So I just want to put some of the pictures here to whet your appetite, right? So we're going to have a dim sum from a Chinese kind of a side of cuisine. And we also have Italian, and we have, of course, some of the authentic American cuisines as well. So I'm going to stop here, and welcome to the RecSys, welcome to the Bay Area, and enjoy the conference.
Good morning. I'm Martin Esther. As one of the two program committee chairs, I would also like to welcome you to RecSys 2014. It's great to put faces to all the papers that we have reviewed over the last few months. I would like to give you a brief report about the review process that has taken place over the last few months. I think this should be the first slide. Just to give you a brief impression and to make that process of the PC membership selection a bit more transparent, we did not just select and invite our friends to serve on the program committees. As a new feature this year, the program committee selection involved a fairly thorough analysis of the publication record using the DBLP digital library. So we analyzed all past RecSys orders and the number and the impact of their publication, not only in RecSys but also in recommender systems related conferences. And then we basically selected and invited the most qualified individuals. As another novelty this year, we strengthened the role of the senior program committee, and we assigned every submission to three PC members and one senior program committee member, and we encouraged a lively discussion among the corresponding program committee and senior program committee members of the corresponding papers. We ended up inviting 101 members to the regular program committee, which was up from last year's number because we needed three program committee reviews because the senior program committee members did not submit a review but just a meta review. And on the other hand, we slightly reduced the size of the senior program committee. We received not only a record number of registrations, we also received a record number of submissions, although the increase was far less dramatic than the increase in the interest to participate in the conference. We received a total of 234 submissions, which resulted, according to our reviewing scheme, in 704 review assignments. We actually received 703 out of the 704 reviews that had been promised, which is, in my opinion, an amazing outcome. And I do want to give a really big thank to all of the PC committee members. And I would like to join you in giving a big hand. This is in my opinion, the core ingredient to ensure the quality of the conference. And I can tell you from my own experience that the reviewers did an excellent and very thorough job in reviewing and discussing these papers. Then we program committee chairs made the final decisions based on the meta reviews and the reviews of the papers. We decided to accept 35 long papers and 20 short papers for an acceptance rate of 23 and 24%. Let us take a brief look at the history of the acceptance rates of RecSys over the last few years to put things into perspective. The acceptance rate of long submissions have been relatively stable, 20%, 20%, 23%. Over the last few years. The acceptance rates of short submissions for ongoing work have decreased quite significantly from 40 over 31% down to 24% this year. And just as a last note here, we did not convert or did not consider rejected long papers for conversions to short papers because we felt that these papers are very different in nature and that it would be quite wasteful to reduce the size of a long submission to its half, and that authors would likely prefer to resubmit their long papers to other conferences, taking into account the feedback that they received from the RecSys reviewers. As another novelty this year, we introduced a new subject area taxonomy, which has been standard in many other conferences already. So this slide lists the top subject areas in terms of number of submissions or percentage of submissions that were listing this area as the primary subject area of the paper. So if you take a close look, there's a couple of topics on methods, various types of methods, top N recommendation, hybrid recommenders, matrix factorization, and so forth. A couple of top topics were in the area of applications, such as e-commerce. Certain topics on evaluation and metrics received a significant number of submissions, and the remaining submissions were distributed over a fairly large number of different areas. Now, we grouped the accepted submissions into research paper sessions with the following titles: novel applications, novel setups, code start and hybrid recommenders, metrics and evaluation, diversity, novelty and serendipity, recommendation methods and theory, ranking and top end recommendation, and last but not least, matrix factorization. And given that this is a single track conference, you will have the opportunity to enjoy all of these eight research paper sessions. On top of the research program, and as a very valuable and a crucial ingredient of the conference. We do have three keynote talks, and we consider ourselves blessed to have three very qualified and exciting keynote speakers. And certainly, being located in Silicon Valley was also in this respect a bonus. You will notice that all of the keynote speakers are locals and basically coming into the front yard. Definitely helped us to recruit these top keynote speakers. We'll be having Neil Hunt from Netflix talking about the value, quantifying the value of recommendations. Jeff Dean from Google will be talking about large-scale machine learning for predictive tasks. And Hector Garcia Molina from Stanford University will conclude our series of keynote talks on Thursday, talking about sharing his thoughts on the future of recommender systems. Well, let me add one last slide here to share just a few personal observations and questions concerning that future of recommender systems. If you look at the submissions and the accepted papers of the conference, you can certainly tell that the majority of the papers have a method focus. There are surprisingly few papers addressing issues of user experience, user interfaces, and so forth, which raises the question, how many new methods and what kind of new methods do we really need, or are we just polishing the round ball here in this area? How usable are our methods? How much value do they actually generate to a user and to real life applications? Are methods scalable to large existing data sets? And perhaps last but not least, where are the new driving applications? We'll have Neil as our first keynote speaker here, and obviously the Netflix prize and the Netflix application was certainly one of the driving applications for the recommender systems community for quite a few years. Where are the new driving applications that inspire future directions in recommender systems? Okay, so this was my short report. Thanks for your attention. Once more, thanks for submitting your papers, for participating in the review process, and I hope you will enjoy the RecSys 2014 conference.
Just when you want technology to work. Okay, there we go. Awesome. Cool, good morning. My name is Anmol Bhasin. I'm with LinkedIn. I'm co-chairing the industry track this year with Joaquin Candela from Facebook. So first and foremost, I wanted to welcome all of you who are traveling from different parts of the world to Silicon Valley. And I thought I'd take a couple of minutes and sort of give you a brief overview of how the industry track is organized this year. So industry track this year is primarily invite only. And I just wanted to share a couple of thoughts around how we, you know, went about thinking about, you know, setting up the whole track. The talks that you will probably listen to over the next couple of days. So Silicon Valley has three big themes, right? It's a hotbed of technology. Obviously, there's giant corporations, technology corporations that have established massive businesses running personalization and recommender systems. So the first session that we'll have is going to be focused on, you know, bringing these mainstream technologies or mainstream companies to talk about what are the interesting things that they're doing in this space, But also, Silicon Valley is known for, you know, it's a hotbed of startups. It's a hotbed of innovation. And the whole context and milieu of this place fosters innovation and new companies and new approaches to come out. So another session is going to be focused on these new age solutions that are coming up, especially in the recommender system space. And then finally, the third big aspect of Silicon Valley is controversy, right? I mean, whether it's Google Glass or self-driving cars or, you know, the controversy surrounds new technology. So the whole theme this year is focused on these three aspects: bring in mainstream technology applications, give you a flavor of what's new and innovative in the space, and then what's controversial. So with that, we'll start off the industry session today with a fun event this evening, which is an industry academia matchmaking session that Alfred Kopsa recommended that we should have. So show up for that at 6 p.m. today. The first actual industry talk session is going to be an established and mainstream session where folks from LinkedIn, Facebook, and Criteo are going to talk about various personalization and recommended system applications that they're operating in their companies. The second session that I'm most excited about is this offbeat and out there session where companies such as Stitch Fix, who are, you know, on the forefront of sort of blending human and machine computation to do recommendations, is going to give us a flavor of what they're up to. There's another company called Shopkick, which is a virtual personal shopping assistant. And so Manu Sharma from that company, he's going to come and share how they're personalizing your shopping experience virtually. And then finally, we also have Climate Corporation, which is bringing recommendations to predicting climate and predicting insurance policies that farmers should buy. So we'll have Eric Andrejko from Climate talk about how they're using recommender systems in their application. So it's a fascinating session. I would highly recommend attending the second session for sure. And then the third and final and the highlight of the industry's track is going to be this panel discussion, which is going to be driven by Xavier from Netflix and Daniel Tunklund from LinkedIn, covering controversial topics in personalization. Last but not the least, I would highly encourage visitors to the Valley to take the opportunity to visit some of the companies in the area. We've set up a program on Friday at 10 a.m. There'll be shuttles leaving the hotel to visit LinkedIn and Facebook. Unfortunately, we had to organize these sessions in parallel, so you can only go to one of them. And if you haven't signed up, I believe there are about four or five spots left on both of these excursions, so I would highly encourage folks to sign up for that. Here's the link. There are sign-up links on that page. Please take the time and visit one of these companies. Thank you for coming. Welcome. Thank you, Alfred.
Everyone, I'm Alan, and I'm a co-organizer of the RecSys Challenge this year. The challenge focuses on user engagement this year, and so user engagement as in predicting the count, the retweet and favorite count that tweets that contain ratings of movies get. This is the fifth year we're running the challenge at RecSys, and and it's been the largest one so far. So we had over 220 teams registered, which is a lot more than we've ever had. On Friday, we'll be presenting 14 submissions. So we have seven posters and seven presentations accepted. So if you're not going to the industry thing on Friday. Come to the RecSys Challenge, 9 a.m. in the Syracuse room. All right, thanks.
It is my great pleasure to introduce to you our first keynote speaker, Neil Hunt. He got a PhD in computer science from University of Aberdeen. For a couple of years after his PhD, he did research in computer vision and image processing. From 1991 to 1999, he worked for Pure Software and its successors in various engineering and product roles. In 1999, he joined his current company, Netflix, and is now serving as their chief product officer, responsible for all the technology behind the Netflix services. Neil, thank you very much for agreeing to present the keynote talk. We are looking forward to your talk. Thank you.
I would ask if the microphone's working, but evidently it is. I feel like I should start with a bunch of charts of how many slides I had 2 days ago, and yesterday, and this morning, and progress towards delivery of this talk, but I don't have those slides. In fact, it's going to be a pretty focused talk on the value of recommenders. So let's see. How many of you working on producing, operating, writing recommender systems? I expect that's like everyone. How many of you are working in the space of cultural products, media, books, music, movies, TV shows? Okay, that's a pretty good number of people. That's a pretty dense audience and the kind of topic that is interesting to me. So let me... I don't know quite why I've gone to the first slide here already, but that'll do. Stakeholders in recommenders: businesses, consumers, producers, and cultural and societal considerations too. So I want to talk about the value of recommenders in each of those areas, and we'll really see where we get to with that. Recommenders have the power for great benefit. We have the opportunity to really change the world, to change the cultural landscape that we work in. And that's a really important, significant responsibility for all of us. But it comes with a flip side. We're entrusted with huge amounts of data from our customers. And they trust us with that data at the moment. But there are some concerns that maybe they won't trust us forever. And so we should be very thoughtful and careful about how we use that data, how we use that trust. So we can do great stuff, but we have to be careful and use that power wisely. That's the core message here. There we go. First, a little background with me. In 1999, I joined Netflix, and there really wasn't a subscription product at that point. There was not much of a product at all. And in fact, I can say that the 1,500 people that work at Netflix right now, some of you are in the audience, 1,498 of them joined Netflix after I did. Only the CEO is longer tenured than I am. I'm not sure if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but it's an interesting fact. So we set out to build a subscription product, and within a few months, we had that product launched, and we realized we had a big problem. And this is the problem. For every DVD we shipped, for every 10 DVDs we shipped, 8 of them would be brand new, straight out of the shrink wrap. And since we were paying $20 to buy those DVDs and getting about $2 of revenue for each shipment that we were delivering, this was not a great business. This was going to be a big problem for us. Now, the main way that people chose DVDs was from a new releases page. So it's really not that surprising that they all chose new releases and that everything we shipped was brand new. But the challenge was, by the time those DVDs came back to us, people had moved on to the next new release, and they sat on the warehouse floor forever. And so this was really a big problem. And I realized very quickly that we needed to get involved with personalization, with recommenders, in order to be able to deliver people different content and spread out the demand on the new releases, and basically to make the pages that were not the new releases page compelling and interesting for people to choose product from. So that was the genesis for me of beginning to work on recommender systems, and we started work with some stuff. We solved the problem, and in about 6 or 8 months, we reached a place where it was actually down from 80% of what we shipped was brand new to about 10%. And of course, now you can buy a $20 disc and ship it 10 times for $2 each, and you're beginning to make some money, or you're on the edge of making money anyway, at least after you've paid back the marketing and other stuff like that. So this was a good start. Now, the recommender we had back in 1999 and 2000 was really not very good. And in fact, we could have achieved most of the goal just by randomizing the page and showing different people different things, because then they wouldn't all rent the same thing at once. But we did slightly better than random. And it was the beginning we started to move forward on that. So 2006 really was, we're on third generation recommender system by 2006 and beginning to really make some progress. But we realized that we needed to reach out to you guys and other people in academia and industry who were working on these kinds of problems. And we launched the Netflix Prize. And I think probably I don't have to say much about the Netflix Prize at all, except since I'm quantifying benefits here, we paid $1 million prize. We got about 10 million hours of work on recommender systems out of that. And I think that's really a pretty efficient way to generate recommender results. So maybe we should actually skip the recommenders and just have a prize for people to do the recommendations themselves, and that might be more efficient. But anyway, 2006, 2009, Netflix prize, lots of work there. 2007, we launched a streaming product. And why is that significant from a recommender perspective? Well, streaming is actually quite different from DVDs. In the DVD world, we had the entire landscape of DVDs. And so the problem was spreading out the demand, but not, it was, wasn't a problem fundamentally of picking and choosing out of a small library, a curated library, something that was interesting. It was managing the demand we had. In the streaming world, we don't have any new content because it's all pre-sold to pay TV. So the only way you get new shows and new films is by making them yourself. And we do that, but we only make one or two at a time, and that's not really enough. So the recommenders in the streaming world are sort of fundamentally more important about generating demand for the long tail product, the long tail content we've got. And so the problem became much more significant during this period as we transitioned to streaming. So today, we have about 300 people working on the problem of discovery. And I broadly can include the algorithms, the user interfaces, which are the platform that those recommendations appear through, and all of the metadata collection and generation that feeds into those things, all of the different pieces that come together. But that's still a big chunk of people. It's about $150 million a year investment in building and operating recommender technology to deliver the value of helping people find stuff they care about. So let's dive in a bit with that background into some of those areas. Why do recommenders matter? Let's step back a bit here. A key piece, take yourself back 10,000 years, and you're sitting in a clan around a campfire, and entertainment is going to be when the clan storyteller, the tribe storyteller, gets up and tells a story, and your choice really is actually there's Bill and there's Fred, and they're both not very good, and those are the stories you've got, and you don't have any choice. the trade radius of the distribution of that story is about as far as you can walk. And for 10,000 years, about as far as you can walk is the trade radius of the spread of culture. It's, you know, your local Blockbuster store, which is a sort of 5-mile radius that reaches about 10,000 households, that will therefore support about 1,000 titles that actually have traction. That trade radius means that our choices are fundamentally not very broad. Or if we think about TV, even with hundreds of channels, the bottom line is that most of us watch about 10 or 20 channels, and when you switch the TV on at 7, there's 10 or 20 things on right now that you have to choose from. It's a choosing problem of 20 things. But with the internet, we've finally reached a place where you really do have, right now at your fingertips, tens of thousands of titles, of products, of cultural pieces to be able to choose from. And that sort of fundamentally changes the game. And the issue here is that we're not very good at choosing across a vast library, a vast catalog of content like that. 10,000 items is overwhelming for everyone. Now, we don't think it is. Psychologically, we think, oh, I'm going to tease through them all and pick out the right one. But in practice, we need a lot of help. And that's where recommenders become crucially important in this space. A key observation for me is we often think of shows or books or music as being good or bad. And the good ones attract an audience and the bad ones don't. But I think that's the wrong way of thinking about it. I think we should think about the size of the audience instead. That there are shows that attract a huge audience, and there are shows that attract a small audience, sometimes very small. But it's our job, creating those recommender systems, to be able to find the exact audience to match each piece of content so that we can maximize the value to the content producer, to the distribution business, and to the audience as well. Let me take another brief digression here into where I see TV of the future, because it sort of sets the landscape a bit for some of the things I'm talking about. Today, we talk about a TV channel. And really, a TV channel is there are 21, 7 times 3 prime hours a week. There are 21 things that matter on that channel. And everything else, the show that airs at 2 in the morning, who cares? So you've got a kind of fundamentally limited choice there. And even if each channel was aimed at a different individual, the range of channels you can get on your TV, 50 or 100 or 500, is still not enough to be able to address the needs and interests of every single person around. So fundamentally, the problem that we have, the problem that faces us as creators of recommendation systems, is to create 50 million channels, each one aimed at a different person. And where that set of 20 things that you can reasonably pick through to choose the thing you're going to watch or enjoy or engage in tonight can be presented in front of you in a bite-sized chunk. A key piece here is that the internet also allows us to get away from, it allows us to establish a direct relationship with our consumers. And because we have that direct relationship, we're able to build directly instead of having to sell advertising. And so I think the future of internet TV is free of ads. But of course, I think there's still a valid business for ad-supported content as well. It won't be Geico, and it won't be the purple pill. Instead, it'll be tailored ads picked by recommender systems that reach out to the people in the audience in a way that's very custom and very specific. The audience wins, because they don't get distracted with useless commercials they're never going to engage with. The ad buyers win because they're able to reach a very targeted audience very efficiently. And the channel wins because they're able to charge a lot more money for those ads and reduce the impact of them, keep things going forward much more effectively. So even in an ad-supported world, recommenders have a huge role to play in improving the world. And we get to richer storytelling. Today, a TV show is a 42-minute thing with room for the ads in that fills the hour. And it ends with a cliffhanger at the end to make sure that you come back next week. Now, that's very formulaic. And I think that the fact that we're able to choose our content not through a TV grid, not by having it delivered on the hour, means that we can liberate it from that constraint, liberate it from that formula. And we can have shows that are short and long, like chapters in a book. In fact, the book analogy is kind of fun. I think it's amazing that when Dickens was publishing, he suffered the same kinds of constraints, and he published his books in 20 episodes of exactly 32 pages of text. That, of course, is a sheet folded four times. And that, you know, that kind of constraint was forced by the cost of publishing and the fact that his readers couldn't afford to buy a whole book at once. And technology solved that problem, and today we have a cheap paperback that puts the whole thing together in one package, liberates the format, and is much more free and open. And I think that's kind of an important observation there, too. Okay, let me get to the guts of the talk here. Let me talk about the four stakeholders. First of all, why do businesses invest in recommenders? Well, it's the economics, obviously. It makes the traditional business better, as with the DVD, or it enables a business that you couldn't do before, like the streaming. We could never have found a credible audience for our streaming catalog, certainly when we began, when it was all very marginal niche titles, without the technology to drive that forward. But that's kind of a bit of a shallow answer. So let's dig in a bit more here. There's a really important tension that we all need to be aware of, and that's the tension of how much do we let economics influence the recommendations and the suggestions we make when pushing forward a cultural product, a book, piece of music, a TV show, whatever it is. So we can either focus on the customers. What do the customers want? What will really make somebody happy? Or we can consider the economics. We can look at the margin available on this product or that product and let that bias or tilt the playing field. We can bias it towards recommending the products that are cost effective versus the products that are exactly what the consumer wants to see. And that's a big tension. We should be very thoughtful about how we deal with that. I think it's a bit of a long-term, short-term problem. In the long term, I think that recommenders that lean towards the customer benefit as opposed to the business benefit will end up retaining those customers better, driving things forward more effectively than the ones that bias or tilt towards the good economics. In the DVD world, our choice was to go for the purest customer model we could manage. Recommend, first of all, without reference to the economics of the product. But then as a last step, to filter out the titles that we didn't have in stock that we were unable to deliver. And that's an unfortunate bias and tilt, certainly not something we would want to do. It was necessary by the business that we had. But we kept that focus on trying to make the recommendations as pure as possible, except for that last step. Fortunately, in the streaming world, we've got less constraints on that. In the streaming world, all of the content is unlimited consumption, and it's all paid for in advance, so there's no marginal cost of delivering one title over another, and there's no kickback for delivering one title over another. And since we don't sell advertising or sell our data, we can really be pure at focusing on customers' interests and making sure that we deliver the best possible recommendation to keep people engaged and happy. That's a great place to be. I know it's not the norm for recommender systems in general, and so that's something to keep in mind. How do you trade off the economic versus the customer value and keep that stuff going forward? I promised to quantify the value of recommendations, so here's the money slide, $500 million a year. The public metrics here, we stream about 7 billion hours a quarter to about 50 million subscribers worldwide, and that makes about 90 minutes a day, which is a stunning amount, really. It's also, this is perhaps the more important number, the most important number for everybody here. It's 150 million choices a day where people make a choice, I'm going to see this, I'm going to see that, I'm not going to see this. And when we put the numbers together on that, you know, a good choice leads to satisfaction, engagement, and coming back again tomorrow, and a poor choice leads to abandonment and risk of cancel. And so if we take that 150 million choices a day and we can apply a recommendation system so that even a very nominal 10% of those choices are better than they might have been, that's a pretty easy bar, right? We're going to let recommender get in there, and can we make it better for 10% of those choices? And if 1% of those choices is better enough to avoid a cancellation, that's worth $500 million a year to Netflix. And so that kind of quantifies the magnitude of the importance of this stuff. I mean, you look at a business like this from the outside, and it's all about streaming and net neutrality and devices and TVs and all the rest of it. This is the biggest number that I get to think about. That's why I have a big chunk of my team focused on this problem of content discovery and making it as efficient and effective as possible. So there we go. We measure with A-B testing our progress, and we move things, train things to move things forward. We measure with some pretty fine granularity here. We look for retention at the 0.1% improvement. That takes a trial with 500,000 subscribers in each test cell. And that's worth, if it's non-recurring, about $5 million, and if it recurs, about $50 million a year. Since retention is a pretty blunt measure, we look at hours of viewing as a good predictor of retention, and we measure that to about 0.1% also. So that's the kind of granularity of improvements necessary to make an economic advantage that's worth having. So hopefully that quantifies a little bit the value there. I want to talk a bit more, if I can get my mouse to work, there we go, about the metrics and the value here. The business value to Netflix is clearly the number of new trials we get, compounded by the retention of those trials, because that's how many people we have paying us $8 a month. Retention is very closely predicted. Of all the metrics we can look at, hours of viewing is the one that best predicts retention. It predicts about 3/4 of our retention value just from the hours of viewing. And so this one is easy to measure, and so we tend to focus a lot on it. Can we improve hours of viewing in a test cell across some learning? And so that's where we get our value from. But we shouldn't forget that people who watch also tell their friends, generate word of mouth that generates new trials. And that, we'll see in a minute, may actually be a bigger piece of the problem. This is a chart I keep on my whiteboard to keep in mind something very important to me as we think about tests and A-B tests and moving things forward. This is 10 new subscribers engaging in our product. And 7 of them are colored green because those guys are going to be very happy with what we've got. And they're going to retain no matter what. And we're going to get the money. In fact, we could send everybody home and we'd have these green guys. And these two guys here, one of them doesn't actually like movies, so I'm not quite sure why he joined. And the other one can't afford it, and his credit card's going to fail. And so they're gone no matter what. And so everything hinges on this one guy in the middle here. And he's the guy on the fence. And all the work we do to make better recommendations, to make discovery easier, to put better choices in front of all of our members, but our testing is seeing whether this one person is influenced to fall on one side of the fence or the other side, not all of these other people. Now remember, I said we measured retention to 0.1%. This is really 1,000 people, and we're focusing all our measurement on one guy in the middle, one guy out of 1,000. That's a pretty blunt instrument, because the better recommendations affect everybody, and everybody has a friend that they talk to. And in fact, this guy who is a super extreme consumer of movies maybe tells all of his friends and generates lots of new business for us. But we're not measuring that because this is all off-site and can't be seen. This may be much more important than whether we retain this guy or not. We just don't have a good way to get our hands on it, to measure it, to understand it. And so we should be very careful at thinking, how do we influence everybody, not just the people we can measure, we can see what's going on for. So that's kind of an interesting thought. There we go. Hours of viewing. We do measure that because it's a good predictor of retention. And this represents a sketch of a histogram of a number of people watching at different number of hours. And you'll see that the median and the average are driven by the very asymmetric distribution. Some people out here are watching, believe it or not, 100 or 200 hours a month, and that really pulls the average up. The median is probably much more significant what the typical consumer is doing. This is 30, 35 hours, something like that. If we change our recommender systems, we make a better algorithm, and it delivers a better result. It's pretty easy, actually, to take these people who are watching extreme high volumes and get them to watch just a little more, or quite a lot more, because they're really flexible. And in fact, this particular sketch I did here, the blue curve, actually has depressed the people watching very little, but dramatically extended the people watching a lot. And it moves the average up quite a lot. It actually moves the median down. It's very tempting to measure all hours or average hours and you're going to get a wrong signal from that. You're going to lean towards influencing the fringe who aren't actually the important customers and not the median who are the important customers. So here's a different algorithmic change. We've got some weird. There we go. Here's a different algorithmic change. This new algorithm has squeezed the curve. It's shifted the middle out at the cost of delivering less good results for the really extreme users. The average has come down. The median's moved up. Again, we would be tempted to look at the total, but looking at a very specific thing. So we measure to a threshold. We measure, can we get 50% of our test cell to engage at more than 30 hours a month? And if we can get 50.1% of the test cell to engage at 30 hours a month, that's a better thing than 50% or 49.9. And that's how we're able to measure the impact on the typical consumer instead of the average consumer, which is not representative. Even after all that, we're still measuring the wrong thing. Because while hours are great predictors, we know that all hours are not created equal. And so how do we get to something that's more fundamental than that? We know that some hours are just addictive filler content, and other hours, while short, maybe knock you back in your seat, wow, and that was really compelling. But given that we measure hours, our recommender systems might machine learn the value of addictive, because that's what moves the metric, instead of learning the value of compelling, which is altogether a different problem, much, much harder to measure. So we really need to be able to figure out how to qualify those hours in making our measurements in setting the objective for our recommenders. Can we qualify the hours to find the valued hours? And perhaps that's things like shows that were watched all the way to the very end, or shows where the user was demonstrably interacting by pausing and rewinding periodically during the show. Or perhaps it was hours where the second episode was watched right away. Or hours watched on a big TV screen instead of on a mobile device. If we can find the right signals there, that's a big unsolved problem. And we may be able to drive things forward even more effectively. But what if the retention driver, the thing that moves the metrics for our business, is actually something completely different? What if it's actually failed sessions? What if it's people who come to Netflix and look at the service and say, there's nothing to watch tonight? And that, I think, is a fairly common problem, one that we would love to depress. Maybe that's the thing we should focus on, avoiding failed sessions. Or maybe what we should focus on is reducing the time to find. I have this very firm belief that we're capable of scanning 20 or 50 titles at most, and then we're bored and we fall asleep or we switch to something else. Maybe if we're not ranking our choices effectively, we're not reaching people in time, and we're generating failed sessions, or we're getting too long to play. Or maybe we should be focused on maximizing the fraction of content viewed. The more shows that people watch and they abandon halfway through, the less good a job we've done. And so maybe we should focus on that as an objective metric instead. Or the velocity of episode consumption, or you can brainstorm up dozens more of these things. So some really key things that are much more deep than just the hours or the retention that will help to drive our business forward. Let's change gear. I've talked about the value to the business and all the ways we need to think about things differently and measure things differently. What about the consumer? What do they care about? And I have some bad news here, I think. When you talk to consumers, as I have done in qual sessions many, many times, in order to figure out how to position recommender systems, how to make people aware, how to get them to participate and enjoy and engage, you get things like this. I don't need suggestions, just give me the good stuff. this is often, I don't need suggestions, just show me the new releases, because that's where the good stuff is, obviously. Or I worry about recommenders because you're going to hide stuff that I might want to watch. I might want to see that, so don't take it away. Keep it on the screen. So I want to evaluate it all, and this sort of sense of bring it to me because I've paid for it, and I want to get it all. So this is how consumers often react to the work that we do. But I think there's a really important moment of truth when somebody sits down in front of our system or your system or whatever it is. Are we going to be successful or not? In my case, I'm pretty sure that we have 60 or maybe 2 minutes, 60 seconds, maybe 2 minutes to find something that will engage and hook that audience and say, wow, this is really compelling. I'm going to watch this. I'm going to enjoy it. Or they flip to a different service, or they pick up a book, or they fall asleep, or they go get another beer or whatever it is. And so I think that means that we have about 20, maybe 50 choices we can put in front on maybe two or three screens or two or three pages that needs to hook and engage that customer, or they've moved on. And so the tens of thousands of choices, we've got to reduce it down to 20 without hiding anything. So it's really a ranking problem at some level. I think that's kind of a pretty key consumer level observation. There's another important consumer level observation here too. It's the spectrum between intrinsic appeal and social appeal of a particular title. By intrinsic appeal, I'm talking to the stuff that I think most of you focus on, pay attention to. It's customers' long-term taste. It's the themes, the styles, and the topics that we've learned over time and over many, many data points that each of you holds dear, and that will allow you to pick something, allow us to pick something to present to you that might be interesting and valuable. And at the other end of the spectrum over here, pardon my stereotype, you have the prototypical teenage female who's actually not very interested in intrinsic appeal, but is far more interested in what her friends watched last night so that she can talk about it with them. And we all have a little or a lot of that in us. What's topical? What are my friends doing? What's the zeitgeist of the moment that attracts people over here? And so I recommend us need to balance intrinsic and social appeal. And for different people at different time and different moods, they're going to fit in different points on the spectrum. Now, recommender systems and a lot of the work we've done is focused right here at this end of the spectrum and really doesn't have a great deal to say about the social appeal. And one of the challenges we have to do is to figure out how to mix in social, how to mix in friends and popularity in a way that delivers that blend that fits on that spectrum for individuals, you know, in the mood that they're in at the moment. And so this could be things like of the 50 things that your friends are watching right now, which ones of those should we rank up highest and show to you and present to you as a friend suggests? Because that will be most compelling. That's sort of nicely in the middle of this picture. But that's a challenge, I think, for us all, is to figure out how to mix and match and blend the social with the intrinsic. Here's a third interesting component, explanatory power. And I think probably this is familiar to many of you. If you present your recommendations as from an oracle, trust me, you'll love this. I think you tend to miss the mark because it's a real trust buster when you make a recommendation that people don't like. And that's a problem. On the other hand, if we can explain our recommendations based on you liking this title or that actor or this theme, we think you'll probably enjoy this. Now you've explained to the consumer in a way that both motivates their choice and gives them an opportunity to excuse failure if in fact it's a miss. I did like that actor, but just not in that work. I do like that theme, but that movie has that theme, but it's not really the dominant theme. And so that's a way that we engage more with our consumers. And if you think about human recommenders, when you talk around the water cooler about what goes on, there's a lot of this feedback back and forth. Yeah, I loved that, but you know, wasn't quite so good here, and his performance was really bad. And we take that into account. And so that sort of explanatory power and the opportunity for interaction there, I think, is important to create recommenders that will really achieve the kinds of goals we care about. Okay, enough with the consumer. Let's think about the content producer, the show producer, or the book author, or the musician, whatever it is, whoever it is who's producing the work. How do they see the work of recommenders? Well, this is an unusual long tail curve. I've drawn it, it's on a log scale. And it's increasing target audience, increasing hours of consumption. This is the piece we expect. There's a cliff. And the cliff happens when a title becomes too small to distribute through whatever trade radius we deal with, or it's too small to feature in our recommender systems effectively, or it's too small to learn enough about what moves it, makes it move forward. And the cliff means that many, many small authors can't get published, they can't get delivered, they can't get distributed, and everybody has to aim for being super popular, and this leads to kind of the downward spiral of commercialization of culture and formulaic productions repeat remakes of movies and so on and so forth. Now, the place that recommenders fit in here, I think, is to... wish I brought a real clicker. There we go. It's to lose this cliff. With great recommender systems, we can learn about even small titles, and we can distribute even small titles to tiny audiences. And so each producer is able to reach the audience they care about. You end up with a much straighter curve here for much longer down. And so this is kind of a democratization of media that I think is a really important phenomenon for the producers of cultural content. Here's a question that I get asked a lot, especially in France, for whatever reason. Does data drive the product? Did we tell David Fincher that she had to die in episode one? And the answer is no, and that's perhaps fairly obvious, but previously, only popularity mattered and people would pursue the formula. You can't evaluate popularity till you've built the product and distributed it, and then you know whether it was successful or not. So there were lots of formulae and ways to build content that was popular. With recommendation systems, we have the data that maps to the attributes, the characteristics of the book we're about to write, or the piece of music we're going to compose, or the movie we're going to shoot. And it's possible to try to use that data to generate the story. Is that a good idea or not? So where we stand on this is we do a lot of work with our data. We take a proposal for an original production or for a piece of content we're going to buy, and we plug in all the data we can about it into our models, and we're able to predict reach and hours for that piece of content even before it exists with reasonable precision, in a way that helps us to say this is worth funding and that's not worth funding. So those are the kinds of places where the data really makes an impact, and that's a huge impact there. We can give insight as to, maybe there's some choices of actress for this supporting role, and there are four proposals, and we can query our data and find out which actress resonates best with the target audience for the show that we're thinking of producing here. And we can give that feedback to the director. Nevertheless, if the chemistry between the popular actress and the star doesn't work, then the producer needs to say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to pick the person who does have the right chemistry, even if it's not what your data predicts. And so we provide the insight, but that's really artistic choice for the director to choose. And we don't dictate that she has to die at the end of season one. The director's choice really matters, or you can really compromise the product that you're delivering. So anyway, some thoughts from the producer's perspective. So finally, let me get to cultural and societal implications of recommender technology, perhaps the least thought about area here. So the media cliff, I already mentioned this, it means that less prominent voices, smaller channels, smaller products don't get an audience. Recommender systems have the opportunity to break that cliff, democratize media, and deliver an audience for even a small niche product. So it frees up directors and producers to build cultural product that would otherwise not get a great audience. Producers are stepping in to fill those roles, and that's really exciting for me to see the landscape shifting and new creative work come out that I think is going to be much more interesting. And there's an interesting side to this. We just launched in France, and we heard a tremendous amount about the great French cultural exception. And the cultural exception, of course, is popularly perceived as wonderful French art. In practice, it's protectionism. In practice, it's a series of policies that limit the distribution of foreign product, make sure that at least 40% of what's distributed in France is French product, that tax distributors in order to fund production of French content, and so probably lowers the bar in terms of general quality of production. I think it's, you can probably tell, I think that's a bad idea for culture in general, and for France in particular. Recommendation systems have the opportunity to get the right culture to the right people wherever they are, globally. And I think the key opportunity here is that a cultural hotbed like France has much bigger opportunity to find an audience around the world for its content, using recommenders to be able to find the very the sparse population of Francophones who really want to see this piece of product and make that happen. Then they have to lose by letting foreign culture invade their territory. If we do the right job with our recommender systems, we can truly enable a global culture to distribute through the whole world in a way that I think maximizes the benefit for everyone. And that's a pretty exciting possibility for me. So the last topic on my list here, echo chambers and filter bubbles. And recommenders have been criticized, in particular politics and newspaper articles, as further polarizing our political landscape by reinforcing the opinions and the ideas and the biases that the readers, the users have, by just showing them stuff that reinforces and never showing them critical and challenging ideas. And I'd certainly say that if that keeps users happy to just keep feeding them the same old stuff, it's unlikely to change. And that could be very problematic. That could be a real downfall in some domains. But I'd say that in our experience, we get more value, we get more interest from our members when we embrace serendipity and diversity and begin to bring in things that have some themes in common but some themes that are different. And so I think there's hope here that if we truly follow the metrics, we'll find that, in fact, people do value having diversity of opinions and different ideas coming in. And that we can, in fact, fill the middle between those sort of left and right political divides. And I would say that even some of the recent work on analyzing the trends in newspaper story recommendations says that the recommenders don't actually influence opinion that much. Opinion's pretty much set, and the newspapers just fill in the gap. I think it's an opportunity for us to help to cross that bridge and pull things together a bit more, and deliver consumer value along the way as well. So let me leave you with four final thoughts. The red is kind of unreadable here. That's okay, because I'll talk to the topics. When you look at the way that humans interact in discussing cultural product, and you see how rich and deep are the suggestions that can come out of that, in spite of the fact that humans don't know their audience that well and don't know the vast landscape of content that well, they can still make really sharp, important recommendations. That makes me think that we have a long way to go. I think we've scratched the surface of recommender systems, but we have a huge distance to go. So I don't think anyone here need worry that we're going to solve the problem next year and then we have to go find a new business. I think we have decades more work in delivering better and better value and really getting ahead of the game here. So that's kind of thing one. Thing two, we depend enormously on vast pools of data. And that data is data that our users have given to us. They've entrusted us to use this data wisely to improve their lives, to give them better choices, to give them better outcomes. And to date, they tend to give us that data without thinking about it too much, and we've built a degree of trust and acceptance that that's an expected outcome. But I think the landscape's changing. You look at Google being sued in the EU for antitrust violations, and you look at the proposals that we've heard for the French regulators to get into Netflix and oversee the algorithm to make sure that it's not biased towards American culture. Those are real things, by the way. Oversee the algorithm, the French government. I think there's evidence that our users might lose their trust in us to be custodians of their data. And so I think it's super important that we treat that with great respect and that we use that data wisely and we don't abuse it. We don't let it escape. We don't let it get hacked. Some of you may remember there was going to be a second Netflix prize, and we ended up canning it because of privacy concerns. People had figured out how to de-anonymize the data in a way that was problematic. And so that was an area where we got educated on the importance of privacy and maintenance and care and custodianship of that data in a really important way, something that everybody needs to be very thoughtful about. We have the ability to do amazing things for our culture, our local culture, our national culture, our global culture. And we also have the ability to descend down a channel of delivering the economically interesting, popular, commercial content instead of being able to find the stuff that really motivates users, the short-term, long-term tension trade-off. And I think it's an opportunity for us to make sure that we think carefully about the long-term and what our customers and our society can really value. But I think it also ends up being good for our businesses, too. But we certainly have a tendency to follow the short-term instead. So my exhortation to you all is be creative, but be humble, and amaze the world with wonderful recommendations. Thank you. So I think we have a few moments for questions, right? More than a few moments, very good. There is another one right here.
Thank you very much, Neil, for this very inspiring keynote talk. We do have more than a few moments for Q&A. We actually have until 10:30, until
Excellent.
Our tea break. So please, do we have a mic for people who ask questions? Okay, we trust that people speak up loud enough, and we ask Neil to repeat the question.
Maybe we can pass your mic into the...
That's why. I'll just repeat the questions.
Oh, okay.
Sure. I think there's about three or four questions in that baked into that. So you touched on ERA, MAE or RMSE was actually the Netflix prize metric. And at that time, we were focused on, so with DVDs, you ship a DVD out and it sits in the home for a week or a month and it comes back to us. We have no idea whether it was good or not. It might have been, no, I don't really want to watch this. What was I thinking? And you send it back. Or it might have been watched five times in a row and passed around all your friends and neighbors. And so we had to collect a rating, a star rating. In fact, I think Netflix was possibly the inventor of the five-star star bar and the idea of a feedback mechanism built in that predicted quality and that it took in star rating scores. And that was the best vehicle we had in the time of DVD. We've moved on since then, and now our work is focused much more on the actual viewing. And we still collect the star ratings, but quality, or rather star ratings tend to be connected with quality rather than enjoyment. And so there's this kind of bias. You're measuring the wrong thing. You're predicting the wrong thing. You're predicting it very accurately. It doesn't actually help deliver the best possible choices to people in the future. And so today we look at what people watch. We look at the context in which they watch it. Did they watch it to the end? Did they abandon in the middle? There's lots of interesting signals we can get around that, and that moves things forward. And so what's the most important thing, you ask, in delivering great recommendations? I would say it's making sure you're measuring the right thing. If there's sort of a message right through the talk here, it's that it's easy to go in and measure our MSE and say we're making great predictions of what people would rate it on a star bar. That doesn't actually necessarily help you to produce great choices for people. You can measure hours, but that doesn't necessarily measure valued hours. You can measure hours as a predictor of retention. Retention's looking at the one green guy out of the 10 or the 1,000. And so having the right metric may be actually the most important question of all. I've given you some ideas about some of the stuff that we do. I think your third question buried in there was a little bit the individual user versus the group of users versus the different members of a household, and the idea of being able to segment the taste into different moods, different personalities, different profiles, and be able to do a little bit of stuff for one person, a little bit of stuff for another person. I mentioned the importance of diversity and serendipity, and I think that's one of the ways that we're able to address both different people in the household. This row has a theme, but the next row is going to be meaningfully different by a diversity measure that we care about, so that if there's somebody else sitting on the couch with you, maybe that's the row that contains something that's interesting for them to watch. And so being able to bring all of that stuff together, I think has been important in terms of driving recommendations performance for us upwards. So hopefully that gets at least some of your answers there. Yeah. Good. Do we see one algorithm performing well in one country and another algorithm in a different country? We have religious arguments about this frequently. I'm the champion of building one single global product, because then we can have that product move forward most effectively for the whole world, as opposed to having 12 different products for 12 different regions, and then each one moving forward more slowly and having to take the learnings from one and apply it to the other. Why do I think that is the right choice? I think it's the right choice because the algorithm is responding to human nature, the way that we react to stimuli and cultural products in general, is governed by a human nature that I think is fairly universal. And so in my opinion, the algorithm is properly a global thing. And the data that feeds it, that's where we pull in the cultural influence, the cultural values that fit into that. And we do, in fact, have different sets of data for each different region that we care about, and we're able to pull from that. But we're finding that the opportunity to use the global pool and to find the people, I'd say that there's probably more similarity between like people across different countries than there is between within the country itself. And so the opportunity to use a global pool of data and use the recommender system to pick out the data that's relevant to you in order to make suggestions for you, that's far more important than picking out the stuff that's from your region, from your country, from your locality, because you'll end up with a homogenized experience and not something that's as rich as it could possibly be. So that's still a little bit of a religious opinion at this point. And since we believe in testing everything, we're in fact embarking in a bold experiment over the next few months of, can we globalize our data pools and get more value from it, or do we really need to stay in a more regional, more culturally biased sense and make that work that way? So stay tuned. Maybe next year somebody from Netflix will come and tell you about how that test worked out. So the question is about diversity and the sort of serendipity factors, and should we plug in more serendipity as we're trying to deal with a diverse group of people? I would say the key observation here is that this is an area where what people think and say is incredibly different from the way they behave. And so the articulations, the kinds of statements that I put on the slide there about people not needing recommendations, just show me the good stuff, or don't hide anything. Those would also lead people, I think, to say things like, you know, I know what I want, you don't have to show me this other stuff too. And yet, I think what we find is that if you bring in the serendipity, if you bring in the diversity in a measured amount, you know, if you're going to explore this theme, it needs to be common and based in reality on some other themes. That actually drives metrics forward in a way that most users would express a disinterest in. And so I think what people say and what you should do are different, and you can use metrics to help arbitrate where the right place is. The question is, do we pay per view to the producers, and is that a temptation to tilt the recommendations in one direction or the other? Well, we exist in a landscape where TV shows are licensed by a terrestrial broadcast channel long before it's aired, and they pay a fixed fee, and then they air it once, and then it's done, or they air it two or three times, but it's sort of really one exposure, one exhibition. And so the price is set on expectations up front. There's a fixed license fee, and then you block the thing out for some number of years, but it's a fixed fee for the rights for a number of years, and that's it. That's the landscape we operate in, which means that we might spend $100 million to license a couple of seasons of a show. But after we've licensed it, the incremental cost of delivering one more copy is the cost of the internet connection, which is the same for any show. So there's absolutely, in our case, absolutely no bias at all from the economics of the show. Once we bought it, it's a sunk cost, and it's done. And the incremental cost is completely negligible. So we don't have any of that interest. I would say that clearly doesn't exist in many other domains where each product has a different margin, a thin margin or a fat margin. And the opportunity exists to bias the recommendations towards the products with fat margin, and that's potentially a problem that diminishes trust, causes the users to tune out from the systems, and you know what I think in the long term be a problematic situation. And so, interesting questions. But we've always taken since the very beginning, we've taken the view that if recommenders are going to be interesting, customer trust is the most important piece. And that we better not violate that by letting other stuff intrude in. We violate the trust all the time by doing poor job of recommendations, and that's something that we're all working on doing better at. But we shouldn't violate it by letting economics slope and tilt in a way that's absolutely avoidable. So hopefully that's a useful. Do I have a specific research topic? I think that question should probably be best directed. I think there's a session. When's your session, Chevy? It was yesterday. Okay. Well, you missed your chance. Go talk to Chevy. He's the guy who's sort of leading forward the initiative for me. So there are lots of things I'm enthusiastic about. One area to offer here is that Tim. I think that we tend to see different algorithms be successful and then want to use those algorithms in lots of different places. And I think that it's likely that using different algorithms in different places leads to a more diverse choice set and to a better outcome. And so that's an important piece. And then a second topic that's very near and dear to my heart. I think we don't pull enough signal out of the core data that our customers give us. I think we tend to use watched or not watched with a threshold of 15 minutes as a binary signal, and I'm convinced that there's more data to be had from the context surrounding it. You know, when they stopped, did they watch something else right away? It was probably a bad choice. Or when they stopped, did they shut everything down? Maybe it was dinner time. very different outcome, same signal. We can know that because we know what goes on around it. And I think that I have some enthusiasm that feeding that into our systems can deliver us a better outcome too. So there's two. There's dozens more interesting ideas, but we'll see where we go. Yeah. Do we pull in data from outside of our own service? We do pull in data from outside. We license data from Nielsen and from the ratings agencies around the world. We pull that in. We look at things like Wikipedia page counts, and we look at Rotten Tomatoes scores, and we license lots of different sources. I think there's about 30 or 40 different external data sources that feed into our systems. That is mostly useful in building the models that predict for a future show that we haven't seen yet what the audience is likely to be. And I don't think those things have much value in terms of making specific suggestions for stuff that's in our catalog to users that we know, because we get such a lot of data points. It's about 60 billion data points a quarter of signals coming in about the content we have. So we go out and reach the external content for content we don't yet have where we're not getting an internal signal. But I don't think it does much for recommendations within. It's used for licensing and purchasing decisions instead. Yeah?
Going back to the pay-per-view question, as a consumer as well, I'm not paying per view. I'm paying a fixed price.
Correct.
This gives me a lot of confidence that Netflix is not going to change me into a couch potato by just taking me on more addictive shows, making me spend 5 hours a day or in front of TV. Why isn't this advertised more?
Why don't we advertise more on the your statement is that because you're not paying per view, we're not encouraging you to watch more and more hours, and so you feel like that. So it's a good question. You know what, I'm not the advertising guru, but I've learned enough that that having a single focus message is the way to make advertising work well. And our single focus message at the moment tends to be focused on a particular piece of content. It's kind of completely the other end of the spectrum to anything that we're working on here. But we get tremendous value from taking an Orange is the New Black launch and making all of our commercials about that. Then we target that to the people who are likely to be interested. And then this quarter we do BoJack Horseman, and we find the people who are interested in that. And because we seek to buy content, we seek to license originals that cover different groups of the population, over a year, our expectation is we'll have several dozen originals, and each one will have a different area of coverage, and then we can use that as a vehicle to send a single focused advertising message, you want to come to Netflix because we got BoJack Horseman, to the very targeted audience that's appropriate for. And so that's the way that our advertising team makes that work. And the other stuff we let people discover along the way. Yes, here.
So you mentioned average hours of viewing as one of the metrics you use for how successful you are. How do you account for the people who stop watching after one thing because they were so impressed by it and they're so satisfied with the few things a month they do get that they don't feel the need to
The question is, so if we're measuring average hours, are we potentially missing a signal because somebody who was completely satisfied stops and is like a vegetable on the couch thinking about what they just watched? Perhaps I'm exaggerating. Of course, the point was we don't use average, we use median because it represents the typical consumer. And in fact, that's a big piece of the answer. The people who tend to just keep on watching and watching and watching drive the average high, but not the median as much because they're above it. And moving the people above the median doesn't change the median, so that doesn't move anything there. I think probably a real piece here is that we measure over the long term. not just tonight, but over a month or 3 months or 6 months. And so if you are truly amazed by that piece of content, then tomorrow you're coming back again. The winning the moment of truth tonight with a really killer recommendation that hooks you tonight means that tomorrow night, when you've got some free time again, it's going to be, wow, I have to go back to Netflix because they've got amazing stuff. And you're not going to your linear TV, and you're not going to the book, and you're not just going to bed. And so we may not see the hours tonight because you were completely satisfied, but in the long term, it will generate ongoing behavior. And that's the thing that drives the metrics forward that tells us that we're doing a good job. How do we balance the need to make quick decisions with the need to wait a long time for the data to come in? Well, it's agonizing. We've built some nifty tools where the product managers are able to see the daily results of viewing hours and predicted retention and all the rest of it. And believe me, the product managers look at those things every day. And we have to have a discipline of saying, no, that's too soon to read. We don't get a signal from it. We need to wait until it's fully baked and come out of that. But I think actually there's probably an important second answer here, which again is better directed more closely to the team. We've done a lot of work with figuring out how to build kind of offline experimentation platforms that let us do what-if experiments based on tracking the actual signals of users and then seeing if we can get a ranking that's more matched to what they actually did in some kind of historic look forward sense. And so there's definitely a lot of interesting work that we can do, but of course that's hypothetical. It's a simulation, it's an experiment. It helps us to tune the algorithms and figure out this might work, this might not work, but you still have to test it in reality in a real A-B test and evaluate the real impact on consumers, because of course as soon as you change the recommendations, you change their behavior, and your recorded behavior that you can use for your offline models sort of veers away from truth pretty quickly. So, interesting tension. You know, the other way we do this is it's kind of the parasite within. We convince the business they need to spend lots of money on marketing, so we get lots of new subscribers so that we can try out new recommendations algorithms on them. I guess that one missed the mark. Never mind. Yes, over here. So the regulators who might want to influence the algorithm, is that a democratically elected set of valid data that we should take into account? Potentially it is. I would say though that there's a strong possibility that regulators anywhere in the world have been captured by special interests in a way that sort of furthers a narrow niche of audience rather than a bigger pile. And so I don't dismiss the data. I think that's a fine and valid input. My expectation, though, is that the way that French consumers actually vote with their feet and choose what to watch is probably more interesting. And I'm going to hold myself back here because I have the benefit of seeing exactly what culture the French subscribers enjoyed on the day one, day two, day three of Netflix launch there. And I can tell you that it's not necessarily what the regulators might have liked to see, but it is what they chose to watch, and that was before we had any input or bias, because it was kind of early days of the service. And so I think the data is pretty clear the regulatory stuff is an important component, but I think it pulls us in a direction that's damaging to global culture and damaging to consumers' interest in, a, in an interesting way. Sure, one more.
So it's a long-term investment that has to do with willpower, which is not necessarily visible in the signaling.
And the comment was that if you had the opportunity to watch Breaking Bad, you would never have learned French. One of the interesting observations here is that a global service has the opportunity to spend money to deliver subtitles and dubs in a way that makes the content much more accessible to a much more global audience. Netflix has been in the lead on, for example, doing subtitles and captions in English to make our product accessible in a way that has not previously been to deaf people in this country. And we've received a lot of value, I think, from doing subtitles in France and Germany, which are traditionally dub countries. And yet we find that almost half of our audience is consuming in subtitles or with no language at all because they're actually more interested in the original language content. So that's another opportunity for global businesses to be able to spread culture in a way that I think is way too easy to shut down if you get insular and protective. In the back there, yes. Do you want to walk to the front? Because I'm never going to hear what you're saying up there. I'll take one more question while you come on up. You're going to have to come up too. Okay, a quick question here. Yeah.
So you mentioned that you're focusing on retaining this 10% of customers who are sitting on the fence, and that it seems to be a good idea to pay a bit more attention to how to motivate the 80% good customers to spread the word in order to more customers. Now the question is, do you have the data? Do you have information, for example, about who makes which referral? Do you have any information about the social network among users?
Yes, good. So the question is about the word of mouth stuff, and are we able to measure that in a useful and interesting way? And fundamentally, if you do A-B testing, the A-B test includes a bunch of people who you can identify on the service, but you can't easily include their social networks in your A cell or your B cell, so it's very, very hard to measure that stuff. We have sought to measure it. We've sought to see, with sign up with Facebook, we can see who's coming in and which friends they were a member of, and can we trace back the new members through their Facebook connections to existing members and the cells they were in and derive a signal from that? We've tried, and I have to say that it's pretty thin, pretty weak. We have an experiment we're running right now, which is a single pop-up that appears once at day 28, which is, will you recommend Netflix to your friends? And the value of that pop-up is precisely to get to that question. It's your likelihood to share the good news and generate that. So the idea is we can take that pop-up, we can include that in a test cell where we're doing different things with the algorithms, and we can see if maybe we haven't shifted hours and we haven't shifted retention, but we have shifted enthusiasm. That test is running right now, so I don't have any data on it, but we're certainly interested in exploring that space.
This was more about how you chose the UI, which now you have grids.
Yes.
Different diversity-based measures of what could be content that you want. So a related question on marketing would be, what about the social explanations that you may have in Netflix, like sort of saying, based on what you want, based on what your friends watch. That was one question. The second was more of a general UX question of how did you actually come up with the design of the grid, and how did you value other ranking measures, such as showing the benefit of UX?
So one question was the general question of the how do we come up with the design of the grid? And the other was a more specific question of how do we bring in the social dimension to that? Let me tackle the second question first, because I'm not sure there's an easy answer to the first one. How we came up with the grid, actually you have to trace this back to when we were doing early work with DVD players and televisions to try to build an application that fit in a TV. And we realized that we were going to build an application included in a DVD player that was going to live for 5 or 10 years, and we would never be able to update. And so we had to come up with a piece of technology that would deliver the latest, freshest thinking to that device for a long time to come without being able to change it and refigure it. And so we thought a bunch about how to do that, and we decided that the right way was, you know, obviously we were going to lay out a set of choices on the screen. So let's do that with what we called a list of movies, so basically a grid structure. Easy to deliver in an API to a device, and easy to code a device to be able to display a set of grids. In fact, we were able to plug into a variety of existing UIs that included that kind of grid structure. And it's really only over a long period of time and many thousands of different devices and iterations and learning that we've evolved that towards, including the billboard and the different presentations and the slight deviations from the grid. There's kind of another important piece here. The early grid stuff we did was hierarchical. And many of you probably used Apple TV, where you control down into genres and subgenres and sub-subgenres. Now, users love that stuff. When you go out and do qual work, you find that users say, oh, let me see the entire catalog, and I can explore everything, and it's great. And the measurements say they get lost. They dig deep, and they get lost, and it's a problem. We've done some other work with the grid structure. We've got the flat grid structure of if we shorten the rows versus lengthen them, do we get a better outcome? And it turns out that, in fact, since the rows are thematic, at the extreme end of the row, you're getting to lower ranked content than just by dropping down to the next row. And there's some evidence in some tests that truncating and shortening the rows to encourage people to keep going down is a good thing. So there's lots of signals and data that come in that help us to steer in a direction that's not what consumers say they want, but which actually delivers a better outcome. And the social stuff, today we fit that in as kind of a row within the structure. I think we need to do a much better job of incorporating that into every row in a different blend or a different mixture. One last question. Who is going to be the last? Sure, why not?
So do you have a concept of an at-risk customer? And when you have an at-risk customer identified, do you do different things to that user, experiment more or experiment less to make that user feel that you're doing a better job?
Do we identify and differently treat at-risk customers? The simple answer is no. The key piece here is what would I do to retain an at-risk customer that I wouldn't also do for everyone else? And the answer is, if I can do a better job for that at-risk customer, it doesn't cost me anything extra. It's not like I'm not incented to want to offer them a discount or anything. That really takes the brand downhill. So it's really about, can I give you a better choice to keep you around? Well, I can do that for free to everybody else too. So there's really no incentive to go focus on the at-risk customer. So we don't even really spend a lot of time identifying the at-risk customers. We know they're there. We see the impact. And frequently, I get calls from people saying, wouldn't you like to apply my model to help predict the customers who are at risk? And I say, well, so what am I going to do about it? I'm going to do a better job for everyone, not just the at-risk customers. So really, that's kind of a core message. Do a great job for everyone. And the at-risk customers are kind of your business value for that and the indicator of that. But that's not really where the value is, because everybody's telling their friends and generating a bigger business in the long term. Okay, be creative, be humble, and do amazing stuff. Thank you. Very good. Thank you. And no, this is mine. I brought mine up because I thought it was going to work, but it didn't do a job. Never mind. That's yours.